Word of God now as we listen to it in part of our worship this morning. Thank you for the preciousness of that song and the precious people that sing it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning. Good day. And we have Jean Kenlin here with us this morning. She's been a couple months. She's been recovering in the hospital and at home and stuff. Great to have you with us, Jean, and precious daughter, precious family. Now, one other thing. Let me get this all fixed up here so make sure I don't lose my way. I'm going to take a quick poll. Who here loves me? Most of you love me. Okay, good. Now, I'm on a commitment from you. Who will love me after this morning's message? You're still, some of you aren't guaranteeing nothing, but that's okay. I'll take 90% of that. That works, because I'm going to hold you to that before I get out of here. I'm holding you to that commitment. I have pictures and cameras taking snapshots. We're working on this series, Whatever Happened to Sex, this series, Black and White. And the premise of this series, as you've been with us, if you're new to the series, and let me just go back a little bit. I was convicted to speak this series back in August while listening to one of my favorite preachers on the radio. Chip Ingram's his name, and I just get a lot from Chip, and one of the few guys I can listen to and just really identify with oftentimes. Chip did this series. He called his series Culture Shock. So I took some of his themes, and I didn't take them all, however. I changed some of them up. But that was where this series was born. And since then, George Barna came out with a research thing, study on the church. And they polled a bunch of pastors, help me with this, Pastor Gold, where there was a 98 or 99%, it was around high 90s, of pastors would not speak on certain subjects from their pulpit, especially the one I'm going to be speaking about next week, which was compelling to me that so many people wouldn't speak on a biblical-based subject because of the fear of the culture. We spoke the first week, and I refer back to it repetitively, Whatever Happened to Truth. If I declare I'm a Christian, and I do, and you do too, most of you, I hope all of you, you declare you're a Christian, then my worldview, at least on paper, I have a Christian worldview. In other words, I see my life through the lens of a believer. I see my life through the lens of a Christian. But we have its basis in the Word of God. What has happened, however, because of society, and because in some cases a simple lack of Bible understanding and Bible knowledge, is we've taken some of the world's worldview and we've married it with our Christian worldview, and we created this mongrel worldview. In other words, I will understand certain tenets of the scriptures, and I obey to a certain point, but when I get to a point where this is uncomfortable for me, or I have to say no to myself, or it denies a current lifestyle which I'm living, I take that and I say, well, everyone's doing it. This is normal in culture today, and it might be. That, my friends, as gently as I can say it, is academic hypocrisy. It just is. I either take everything what the scripture says. I don't look at the words of Jesus and pick and choose what I want to believe. We brought out last week, he believed in a creation. That's what we spoke about last week, Adam and Eve, and the create when God spoke the world into existence. If you weren't here last week, you can go online and get that message. At the very least, it'll inspire you to go a little bit deeper on it and to look a little bit deeper. But Jesus taught that. So I'm going to believe that the words of Jesus, like he's the Son of God. If I believe he's the Son of God, then I should really probably believe the rest of what he says too, that the world came from a creator. So with that said, I'm not aiming at anybody. There's not a judgmental bone in my body. People know that. I'm not here to point the fingers. If anyone hunts duck, anything, don't, all right, so no one hunters. If a flock of duck go overboard and I shoot some buckshot at them, I might get two or three ducks. I'm aiming at that one because I have a lot of buckshot up there. So if that happens a lot in messages. I might be thinking about a particular case, but I'm hitting a lot of other ducks. and so understand, this is very broad. If it applies to you in some way, hallelujah, God's speaking. If it doesn't, then you've already promised to love me after. So I'm good. We're good. If it speaks to you, great. If it doesn't, The biggest thing with the Word of God, my friends, it only impacts us if we obey it. Truth is truth. You could say, I don't believe any of this, Pastor, and that's okay. But understand, you have a non-Christian worldview. You can say, I don't believe it, and that's okay. But you have a non-Christian worldview, and that's what you need to come to grips with. I don't want anyone to leave here in self-deception. That would be against my goal for the whole series. Just in the late 40s or 50s, I had a lot of statistics here. I'm actually going to wean them down a little bit because they're overwhelming. About 5% of the girls in high school and about 10% of the boys in high school were sexually active. Fast forward 50 to 60 years, 70% of girls and 80% of boys in our public high schools are sexually active. 70 and 80%. My numbers come from Billy Graham. They come from Chip Ingram, and they come from the CDC, the Center of Disease Control, who does a lot of this stuff. You got it right from their website. Today, 50% of all women under 30 cohabit with someone prior to marriage if they are married. They live together, 50%. The divorce rate in the late 40s, decades of the 50s, were single digits. The divorce rate today is over 50%. Sometimes we, the church, we look at these horrible things I'm saying, and I said, I know it's bad out there. I was talking about the church. That wasn't the world. That was statistics within the church. 1969, no-fault divorce was instituted. 1996, evangelical divorce rate was 4% higher than the national average. In the Bible Belt, it was 50% higher than the national average. There has been a cultural shift, my friends, inside the world concerning people's sexuality, and it's been a cultural shift inside the family, and because of that, it is a cultural shift concerning sexuality inside the church. Outside the church, culture and society, it's a norm. They know nothing different than that. This is where I live. This is what my normal would be. If I'm sending a teenager to a public school, that's normal. This is just the normal. That's what they would call their normal. And you fit that into any age bracket that you want. Inside the church, however, going back to week one, we have a different lens we're supposed to see things through. That lens of our worldview. And that worldview is supposed to be anchored right in the written Word of God. That's the lens. I filter everything through this. I filter my money, my marriage, my sexuality, my ethicals, my moral life. I filter that all through the Word of God. This is broken down, however, in the church. And again, maybe because of the lack of knowledge, the church now embraces in many areas, and that's why we're having this series, the church embraces a non-Christian view. And in this particular message this morning, the non-Christian view of sex than the view that the scriptures give us. In 1987, 75 million people rented porn. Let me say this. After church, if you struggle with the issue of porn, we'll be down in Pastor Burnside and I'll be here. I'm not going out back. I'll be here to pray with you. I have resources for you. I'm not going to condemn you because there's no reason to condemn you over that. It's sin. Just like gossip. That's it. So understand, not pointing any fingers. 1992, 490 million rentals of porn. 1996, 655 million rentals of porn. Let me make sure I actually have different more porn stuff down here. All right, average age to first internet exposure to porn, 11 years old. Promise keeper men who viewed porn in the last week, 53%. Christians said that the major problem in their home, porn, 47%. U.S. News and World Report says the distributor of porn in the world has its heart here in America. We distribute more porn than anyone else. And my friends, in America, the number one distributor in porn is Tampa Bay. Many of you didn't know that. Back then, way back then in the 80s, the distributor, there was 150 new porn titles per week. Once the internet came to us, they don't even count them anymore. About 40% of men in America visit a porn site regularly, and the percentage of women is increasing dramatically. Recent statistics show that 50% of partners in marriage have committed adultery. There is a website, it's been out numerous years now, that if you pay a fee, they'll help you commit adultery and hide the fact from your spouse for a fee. No, I will not give you that website. 37% of pastors have admitted off the record that they have done the same. Proverbs 6, verse 32 and 33, I don't have my ad lib since the first service. He who commits adultery lacks sense, and he who does it destroys himself. He will get wounds and dishonor, and his disgrace will not be wiped away. I think adultery is, first of all, very mean to do that to your spouse and to hurt them in such a way. It's just mean. I think there's a lack of fear of God sometimes. I know in my life, I fear God. I've always feared God, and I fear Peggy. Sometimes I get mixed up who I fear most. I'm not really sure. I mean, I think God would forgive me quicker than Peggy would. In fact, I can almost guarantee God would forgive me quicker than Peggy would. So there's a healthy fear in me. 60% of men and 40% of women will have an extramarital affair. Christians report that 45% have acted inappropriately, sexually inappropriately. 23% committed adultery. 40, these are Christians that they admit. Billy Graham said a recent poll claims that 40% of young people in evangelical churches are sexually active. 60% of single adults, including those who attend church regularly and participate in Bible studies, are not only sexually active, but half reported sex with multiple partners. There was a Bible conference, and a professor from the college was there talking to people about sexuality. She said this, it's a she. It's fine in a church to stand up and talk about God's ideal for sexuality, so like I'm doing today, in marriage and all the rest, but the fact of the matter is, we know people in their 20s and their early 30s are not going to be sexually celibate. So at the church, what we need to say is, yes, there is an ideal, but we need to provide contraceptives in Bible-believing churches so that people disobey the damage. They will disobey, the damage will be a little bit less. So what's he saying? Saying, yeah, okay, yeah, we know it's wrong, but instead of just dealing with it from a spiritual level, we should pass out contraceptives. That was the wisdom of this Bible seminar. In other words, the Spirit of the living God, more about this later, living in the Christians now, 2014, does not have the same power to encourage us and to allow us to obey God than it did 2,000 years ago. So we should just make, quote Jesus, a provision for the flesh. 2012, my friends, the number of live births to unmarried women was 1.6 million. 2012. Percentage of all births to unmarried women, 40.7. I won't break that down by demographics or nationality. I'll say this, though. The state with the lowest single mother birth rate, Utah, 17%. A home of Mormonism for a family. We have a problem. The church has a problem. And unfortunately, we don't always know it. We don't think that we have a problem. We think that somehow it doesn't apply to me, or maybe I don't know, or sometimes we make the deception, my friends, to think that God takes his book and violates it. That somehow God takes his written word and says, this will work everywhere but in your life. In your life, it doesn't apply to you, sweetheart, honey, man. power in the written word of God, Hebrews 4:12, is able and sufficient to let God's people live in a godly way. And hopefully we'll see that a little bit more. So with that said, what does the Bible say about sex? Well, come Wednesday night, and we'll fill you in. Thanks for being here this morning. Just messing with you. First of all, God is pro-sex. I knew you were going to say that. I knew you were going to say that. Some guys went, woo, 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 woo. Yeah, God, he is. God is pro-sex. God is not a prude. If he was a prude, he wouldn't have made man and Adam and Eve the way he made them. He would have figured out another way. He would have just gave like a pack of seeds or something like that. And we would have planted humans. But he made us anatomically different. And so we would have sex. Adam and Eve, they had sex. So there are three Hebrew words for sex when it goes into the Old Testament. One is to lie with. You've read it, especially if you have an old translation, King James, American Standard, whatever, to lie with. The second is to go into, and the third is to know. It's interesting how God uses it. When David, he lied with Bathsheba. Didn't really say he knew, he said he lied with Bathsheba. When a man goes in, he says he goes into a prostitute. Talks about a sex act. Again, I told you this is PG-13. And some of you are like, oh man, I'm blushing. Just put a bag over your head. It'll be fine. I'll get you out of here in good time. And next week's going to be worse, okay, just so you know. When sex isn't sanctioned from God, he uses those words. Yet when he describes Adam and Eve in Genesis 4:1, he says Adam knew Eve. Interesting. The word know there, new, is a Hebrew word, yada, a very common Hebrew word. It's not used exclusively for other things. But it talks about an intimate knowledge, a exchange, an acquaintance, a relational type of thing that goes back and forth between two people. It's not a casual word. It talks about something deeper than just skin deep. It was the culmination in terms of physical reality of what they were sharing at the heart and the spiritual level. God saw the sexual bond between a husband and a wife as the deepest bond, as the marriage is the highest human relationship. The sexual bond of marriage, my friends, is the highest expression of that relationship. Sex needs to be guarded in the marriage. I get this from the scriptures. I'll read to you in a few moments. But I get this just from 30 years of being in the pastor's seat and talking about things. And I shared the first story. My first full-time ministry job, I was a principal of a Christian school. I was about 25 or 26 years. I don't remember now. It's like 10 years ago. And some of you guys goes right over your head. And I was pretty excited because I had a Bible college degree. And people were going to come and get counseling from me. I had something to say. I had an answer for every one of their problems, I guarantee you. And the first time I got a knock on the door, a mom from one of the students came in and said, "Can I talk to you?" And she's crying. And I said, "Yeah, come on in." And I sat down in my little pastor chair, and they said, "My daughter's molested." I said, I remember the blood draining out of my face. And looking at them, having nothing to say, but "I'm so sorry. I'm just so sorry." You know, during that year, my friend, that first year in my little Christian school with about 80 students, it was seven, I had that conversation seven times with parents and children in the course of that year. Seven times in that little school, all in my middle school age group, there was children abused, sexually abused by adults. In that course of the year, there's three of those people went to jail that I remember, and that's a long time ago. It's a problem. It's a problem. So bear with me here. Sex needs to be guarded in the marriage. I understand all the reasons not to have sex. I do. If you've been married for a while, I don't feel like it. I understand that. I'm exhausted. I understand that. Dads, if you took care of kids all day long, you came home, I get it. I understand all these reasons. I'm so tired by the end of the day, I can't even think of doing that. And how about this one? I've heard this about 7 million times. My husband doesn't pay attention to me all day long. He comes home, he sits in front of the TV set, he watches Bill O'Reilly, and sometimes after Bill O'Reilly's done, all of a sudden he's attentive.
Oh, baby. Look at you, sweetheart. Show me there.
And it comes a little rose in the teeth, plastic one, and all of a sudden gets very romantic all of a sudden, because now he's getting these, I think I want to have marital relations with my wife. So I can ignore my wife all day long, and then she's just going to, oh, thank you. Doesn't work that way. All right. But with that said, I've heard that. So this is what I'm going to tell you. If your husband's that way, never have sex with him. Okay? That should solve the problem. No, it's not going to solve the problem. It's going to make it just the opposite. It's not going to solve the problem. One member in a marriage walking around in continual sexual frustration for a long time, I guarantee you, has no good results. At the very minimal, what's going to happen is resentment and bitterness will creep in to that person, whether it's the guy or the girl. Resentment or bitterness will creep in at some point and begin undermining the fabric of that marriage. I have more stories about this than I can even tell. One comes to mind where a dear woman came in and we were talking about other issues, not the marriage. In the conversation, the marriage came up. Very dissatisfied. Husband was dissatisfied. Scenario I just laid out for you. You'd come home from work, go into the garage, work in the garage, tinker around with the stuff, crawl out, take a shower, go to bed, and do it again tomorrow. Very little interaction within the home, very little interaction with the family. I said, well, what do you think the problem is? He goes, well, I think he's mad because like, we never have sex. We never share each other. We never have intimacy together. I said, well, what's stopping that? Is it something you can't do? No, I can do it. I don't want to. I don't feel like he loves me. I don't even want to have sex with him because I don't like how he treats me. Okay. He says, so, but when you do have sex, how does he treat you? Great. Oh, all right. So we went to the scriptures a little bit, and I said, if you can, and again, I know I'm oversimplifying this, and I know this is PG-13+, but bear with me. If you can, and it ministers to him, and it makes him closer with you, then why don't you? And she looked at me and goes, I guess I could. Okay. A month or two later, whenever she came in again, we talked. And it wasn't even the issue. That was a side issue. And I said, how's it going at home, by the way? Goes, oh, much better. Just great. Really, what happened? He goes, well, I did what you said. I just started having regular relations with my husband. And now he's in the house. We're watching TV. In fact, he didn't get out of my hair. He's like all around me all the time. He's like a bee looking for honey. and he's just like all over the place. And I said, it's really great. It hasn't been this good in a long time. See how it works? I'm not saying it's going to work like that all the time. I'm not saying it's that easy. I'm just saying the scriptures lay out for us something that we want to listen to. I'm going to read these to you right now in just a moment. The temple of Aphrodite, she was in Corinth. Corinth was a nasty city. It was the Amsterdam of today. It was just a lot of perversion there. People would come from all over the world to come to this city because there was a temple of Aphrodite and they'd have sex. That was worship, having sex. And they'd go in these temples and they'd have one prostitute after another. So it's, with that in the background, understand what Paul is writing to when he writes this to, and I'm going to read in chapter 6 after this, when he writes this to the people of Corinth. Now as to the matters which you wrote me, this is 7 verse 1, it is well. And this is Amplified Bible. And by that, I mean advantageous, expedient, profitable, wholesome for a man not to touch a woman, okay, and to cohabit with her, but to remain unmarried. Cohabit with her. But because of the temptation to impurity and to avoid immorality, let each man have his own wife and let each woman have her own husband. Like pets. And a husband should give his wife over her conjugal rights. Wow, look at that. Goodwill, kindness, and what is due to her as a wife, and likewise the husband, the wife. Paul's getting pretty down and dirty here. For the wife does not have exclusive authority and control over her own body. Oh, yes, I do. I'm just reading you the scriptures. You can accept them or reject them. You can adopt a Christian worldview or reject a Christian worldview. But the husband has rights. Likewise, also the husband does not have exclusive authority and control over his own body, but the wife has her rights. Most husbands saying, I'm okay with that. Now it goes on to the next one. Do not refuse or deprive or defraud each other of your due marital rights. That's talking about sex. Okay? Understand. Now I'm going to do this with you, and I want you to do this if you can. It's going to be hard. Say this after me. Sex. Some of you went roll off. The other ones like just fainted. But that's okay. It's not a dirty word. God actually said this is good. This I made this to be good. I made this to bring your marriage and intimacy into your marriage. Except by mutual consent for a time so that you may devote yourselves to unhindered to prayer. But afterwards resume marital relations lest Satan tempt you to sin through the lack of restraint of sexual desire. So if sexual desire is not met continually over a long period of time, what's the Apostle Paul saying? He says, we're opening up a door for Satan to tempt us. Ephesians 4:29 says, neither give place to the devil. Don't mark off boundary ground. Marked off boundary line. So here it is in marital sex. God says, I want you to have sex. In fact, sex enhances the marriage, builds the marriage up. Now, is there going to be times when one of you just don't want to? Yeah. That's okay. As long as you know it's not going to be 3 months before the next time you decide to have sex. I mean, you know what I'm saying? It should never go that long where one is being deprived of the physical aspect of marriage. I don't want this to make you feel uncomfortable, my friends, but listen, this happens. This happens a lot. There's a lot of tension in a lot of marriages because of this. And when I deal with marriages in the counseling office, and I've dealt with a lot of them, this always comes up somewhere. Very, very rarely is it not an issue. So what does the Bible say about it? And let's look at it and launch from there. I'm married, how long? 29 years, you gotta know that. And I had to do more math in my head here. Sorry, honey. And there's some times when there's been real physical ailments, especially in my wife when she was very, very ill. Sometimes for numerous years. Everything was hindered. But no matter what we did, we guarded that part of our marriage. Probably just not even understanding, but understanding that if we're going to love each other without this subtle bitterness, resentment, whatever that is, it just wants to simmer there because someone's not getting their needs met. And that's not just the guy always. Sometimes it's the guy that's defrauding the wife more times than you'd think. We have to deal with this little Victorian prudishness that we may have in us. Sex is a gift from God. It's okay. It is not dirty. And I'm going to say this subliminally. You won't even hear it being said, but it's going to go into your brain. Get married. Sex is okay in marriage. See, you didn't even know I'm saying in marriage there. It's just going right in subliminally. Sex is perfect. It's ordained by God. God wants you to have sex in marriage. See, this is how we get across to you, subliminally. God's purpose of sex was to create a bond within the marriage as well as procreate. No sex, no church. And to have children. In the 1970s, about 500,000 couples lived together before tying the knot. Now upwards of several million couples will live together, according to WarTech, before they marry. According to one estimate, and there are different estimates out there, 60 to 70% of today's couples will share a residence before marriage. According to Reader's Digest, 30% of those people will have a higher rate chance of divorce than those who haven't previously lived together. How stuff works, maybe you've seen that on the internet. I just looked up certain things. Numerous researches are finding that couples who live together have a higher rate of divorce than couples who don't cohabit before marriage. And prior to the divorce, these couples have a lower rate of marital satisfaction. Is there any wonder that when God says we wait before we move in together? Sorry for being so honest. No, I'm not. There's a reason. And when we do it God's way, there's a blessing on it. And when we do it our own way, we shoot ourselves in the foot. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 15 through 20. you say food was made for the stomach and the stomach for food. This is true, though someday God will do away with both of them. But you can't say that our bodies were made for sexual immorality. They were made for the Lord, and the Lord cares about our bodies. And the Lord will raise us up from the dead by his power, just as he raised our Lord up from the dead. Don't you realize that your bodies are actually parts of Christ? Should a man take his body, which is part of Christ, and join it to a prostitute? Never. And he's really talking about having any extramarital or unmarried sex. That's what he's talking about. It's not just a prostitute. It's any sex outside of marriage. Never. And don't realize that if a man joins himself to a prostitute, because he's talking about the people in the temple of Aphrodite there, that's what he's going after, he becomes one body with her. For the scripture says the two are united to one. So when God puts the sexual union together between a husband and a wife, he sees them as being what? One flesh. He created that anatomically. He created that so God sees a one flesh union, the highest union on earth, a husband and a wife sharing sexual intimacy. But the person who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Run from sexual sin. No other sin so clearly affects the body as this one does. For sexual immorality is a sin against your own body. Some of you might not even know these verses were there. You may, if you're not a regular diet of the Word of God, you might not have ever read these before. But this is pretty clear, isn't it? This is not gray. This is black and white. Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? We're regenerated. Where God lives inside our hearts. Who lives in you and was given to you by God. You do not belong to yourself. But God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. He's speaking about a higher life. Was it cultural back then to go to the temple and worship with Aphrodite? Yeah, that was cultural. Was that normal? Everybody did it. People came from all over the world and they did it. That was very absolutely what society and culture would do. If I was going to interpret my life through culture, that would be what people would do. Premarital, extramarital sex, joining with the prostitutes, just having the sexual wantonness, that was okay. That was normal. That's what they did back then. Ephesians 5, verse 3. Now, I'll just say this. In this city, there was another temple called Diana. Same type of worship principles, sexually based. And so he says this to the church at Ephesus. But sexual immorality, I'll interpret that for you, that's fornication in your older translations, and all impurity or covetousness must not be named amongst you as is proper among the saints. You know what Paul's saying? He goes, I know they're all doing this out there. He's saying this to Corinth and Ephesus. I know they're all doing it. I know they're all doing it. I know it's normal to them all there out there, but it's not normal to us. We are Christians and we have our temple of the Holy Spirit and we stand for something holy and right and not what we don't stand for what they stand for. And greater is he that's in me that's in the world, so I can say no to these things, if I must. Now, this word sexual immorality is this Greek word porneia. You know where we get that word from, is pornography. Porneia. Now, this is an interesting word because in your King James and others, it'll say fornication. Usually, when you read that, if you even know anything about those old languages, they'll think that's premarital sex, and then you have adultery, which is extramarital sex. Fornication's adultery is pretty narrow. Extramarital sex. But fornication is a big word. It's an umbrella word. It talks about a lot of everything. I had a young person tell me recently, says, you know, Pastor, we don't have sexual relations, me and my boyfriend, but we do other things because as long as we don't have sexual relations, sexual intercourse, the rest stuff is okay. Okay. And they meant that sincerely, and they weren't deceptive. They were just didn't really know what the Bible taught. So let me show you what the Bible teaches. Porneia is premarital sex. Porneia is extramarital sex. Porneia is sexual contact without intercourse. These are not my words. These are words of others that I've cut and pasted in to define this term. Nakedness for the sake of sexual stimulation. Internet sexual romances. Flirting. Dressing to entice another into sexual excitement. Pornography. All sexual practices outside of the covenant of marriage. come under the umbrella of porneia. It's a large word. It's all-inclusive. It can be translated sexual immorality. Oftentimes it's translated in your different uncleanliness. And oftentimes it's translated fornication. But understand, the English word and the Greek word is very different. The Greek word opens up the whole realm. And King James says, let it not be named once among the saints. There is a deception in the church, my friends, that only, again, sexual intercourse is prohibited. That's not truth. That is not black and white. Now, before I get into why God wants you so miserable, if I'm hitting you this morning, you say, geez, you know, that's me. That's us. Don't leave wagging your head between your tail, just with your tail between your legs. This is a chance to fix it. This morning's a chance to fix it. Maybe the lights went off. Maybe you knew the light, but you didn't want to acknowledge it. Maybe I've been so blunt today that you couldn't deny it any longer, but this is the chance to fix it. It's a chance to, for you and God. I'll be down front for prayer after. Pastor Bernstein will be down for prayer after. If whatever the issue is, sexual addiction, whatever the issue is, this is a chance to address the issue, because God has a better life than that. He has a higher good for you. When God prohibits something, sex is holy. God made it. It's holy. When he prohibits something, it's not to make you miserable. He didn't give you the sex drive to make you miserable, my friend. When the scripture has prohibitions, the prohibitions are there to protect us. I use the illustration a lot. If there's a fork in the road and Andre's here, and I say, and Andre goes, hey, Tim, which way do I go? I said, go that way. There's a pit in the road up there with four tigers in it that haven't been fed in 2 weeks. And you won't see the pit. Yeah, go that way. So he falls in the pit. He comes back all scratched up. And said, why didn't you tell me? He goes, I'll just let you make that choice. No, I should have warned him that there was a pit up that road so he could take another road. And that's what the scriptures give us. The scriptures give us warnings. The Bible, through the wisdom of the Word of God, the inspired Word of God. Again, if I believe that, the inspired Word of God gives me prohibitions to warn me from things that will bring pain and inflict damage into my life. So coming under the umbrella, the covering of the Word of God, isn't me saying no, I'm not being me being weird, it's me being smart, saying, look, I don't know the end result of these things, but the Word of God does. So even though I may not understand exactly what I'm obeying, I'm just going to obey it because the Word of God says it, and I come under a level of protection. If I ask for a show of hands, and I won't, how many of you have made decisions in your life, I'll raise my hand, that have violated the Word of God, and you found out 1 year, 2 years, 10 years later, that was a really, really bad decision that brought pain into my life, whether it be an addiction, a relationship, or whatever that is. Most of us could draw a line back to that, couldn't we? So we embrace the truth that this life in me, the temple of God's Spirit, is ample for me to repel and to control and to channel this natural desire for sex. I'm a believer, so I view all sexual contact as a gift reserved for the marital union. My friends, I deal with a lot of things. I've never seen anything control or damage people's lives, probably 5 to 1, than I have seen sexual sin and the ramifications, from an unwanted pregnancy to damaged emotions to whatever it is. 5 to 1 from anything else that comes across my desk. Much more than alcohol, much more than drugs, much more than substance abuse issues, is sexual sin. It has done more damage to God's people than I've seen in my ministry in going on 30 years. So I say all this now. I'm asking you to start and end where we begin. Who loves me? Bunch of hands didn't go up this time. Only about 70% of the hands went up this time. I had 95% the first time they went up. Good, you love me. So anyway, you'll forgive me if I because I didn't want to, certainly not aiming. I don't judge. My friends, I want this to be a help. Whatever happened to sex? That's what the Bible talks about sex. The Bible is not one massive orgy. The Bible just simply describes it in marriage. It's a gift from God, sanctioned by God. Should be enjoyed between a husband and wife as much as possible, as frequently as possible. And outside of marriage, it's meant to be reserved for marriage. Amen? Jesus, thank you for these precious people and their spirit of humility. The worship team can come on up. We'll have a closing song. the spirit of humility that's amongst them. And Father, we just pray that you would bless this message to our hearts. If you're here today for the first time or on the webcast, and you've never asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior, we'd like to give you that opportunity right now. Not joining our church, to say to yourself, Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. Come into my life and save me. If you said that prayer and you said yes to Christ, please let me know or let one of the pastors know on the way out the door, on the webcast. Let us know online, even right now. And Father, we pray a blessing on each member in particular. And God, if a couple got convicted today, then God, we pray that they make the right decisions to fix what they need to fix and come under your blessings once again. If the marriage was, people in their marriage was convicted today, we pray that they'll come under the, they'll make what they need to make right with each other and with you, and then they'll come under your blessings again. We just take that this message, never to condemn, never to point the finger, never to wag our fingers, never just to complain about the bad things in the world. We see every message as a chance for redemption and for God, for you to breathe into it and be glorified. And by you being glorified, lives are blessed. Father, bless this message to our hearts. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Folks, I'll be down front for prayer. Pastor Burnside will be down front for prayer during this last song. Then I'll dismiss you when the song's over.